Sunday, right after our services. Kids have been working hard, they really might see you all there. Deal. And let's begin the Lord be with you.
No, I said, we've got last day for flower signups.
Okay, flower signups, yellow sheet, should it be any material? The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be God's kingdom now and forever.
Whoever serves, we must follow me, says the Lord, and where I am.
There you will be served me also.
Let us stand and sing our preparation then. Teach us to love and serve you faithfully and reconcile us to you and to one another as members of one living body through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Trusting in God's grace, let us confess our sin.
O God, through the season of life, we have prayed for clean hearts and right spirits. Forgive us, O Lord, if we have prayed with our words and failed to pray with our actions. Forgive us the wrong we have done and has contributed to suffering and none other. And forgive us the wrong we have failed to do and have given body to the neighbor's burden. Forgive us, O God, and wash us in your mercy. Forgive us, O God, and forgive us for our sin.
Please take a moment for silent personal confession. Christ our Lord.
Amen.
to each other in place.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Hi.
Good morning.
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 Good morning. Let's join together in the prayer for illumination. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Bless us, Lord, who causes all these scriptures to be written for our learning. Grant us so to hear them, read, mark, learn, and inwardly digest them, that we may embrace and ever hold fast the blessed hope of everlasting life, which you have given us in our Savior Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
And our first reading is from the prophet Jeremiah, chapter 31. God says, I will make a new covenant, writing my law in your hearts. Hear now the word of the Lord. The day is coming, says Yahweh, when I will make a new covenant with the people of Israel and Judah. This covenant will be not like the one I made with their ancestors when I took them by the hand and brought them out of the land of Egypt. They broke that covenant, though I love them as a husband loves his wife, says Yahweh. But this is the new covenant I will make with the people of Israel after those days, says Yahweh. I will put my instructions deep within them, and I will write them on their hearts. I will be their God, and they will be my people. And they will not need to teach their neighbors, nor will they need to teach their relatives, saying, you should know the Lord. For everyone, from the least to the greatest, will know me already, says Yahweh. And I will forgive their wickedness, and I will never again remember their sin. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And then in response to that is Psalm 51, verses 1 through 12. Create me a clean heart, O God, and put a new spirit in me. Have mercy on me, O God.
Because of your unfailing love.
Because of your great compassion.
Blot out the stain of my sins.
Wash me clean from my guilt.
Purify me from my sin.
For I recognize my rebellion.
It haunts me day and night.
Against you, and you alone have I sinned.
I have done what is evil in your sight.
You will be proved right in what you say.
And your judgment against me is just.
For I was born a sinner.
Yes, from the moment I know what is easy.
But you desire honesty from the womb.
Teach me wisdom in the air.
Purify me from my sins, and I will be clean.
Wash me, and I will be
clean. Oh, give me back my joy again.
You have broken me, and I will let you.
Don't keep looking at my sins.
Remove the stain of my guilt.
Create in me a clean heart, O God.
Renew the loyal spirit within me.
Do not banish me from your presence.
And don't take your Holy Spirit from me.
Restore to me the joy of your salvation.
And make me willing to obey you.
Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever.
Amen. And then our second reading is from Hebrews 5:5-10. Jesus Christ, our high priest, is the source of eternal salvation. That is why Christ did not honor himself by assuming he could become high priest. No, he was chosen by God, who said to him, you are my son, today I have become your father. And in another passage, God said to him, you are a priest forever in the order of Melchizedek. While Jesus was here on earth, he offered prayers and pleadings with a loud cry and tears to the one who could rescue him from death. And God heard his prayers because of his deep reverence for God. Even though Jesus was God's son, he learned obedience from the things he suffered. In this way, God qualified him as a perfect high priest and became the source of eternal salvation for all those who obey him. And God designated him to be a high priest in the order of Melchizedek. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let's stand for the reading of the Holy Gospel.
Now
John chapter 12, verses 20 through 33.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
The Lord be on my mind about this. Jesus says to you, now I will be glorified. I will die and be lifted up. So Greeks who had come to Jerusalem for the Passover celebration paid a visit to Philip, who was from Bethsaida in Galilee. They said, sir, we want to meet Jesus. Philip told Andrew about it, and they went together to ask Jesus. Jesus replied, now the time has come for the Son of Man to enter into his glory. I tell you the truth, unless a kernel of wheat is planted in the soil and dies, it remains alone. But its death will produce many new kernels, a plentiful harvest of new lives. Those who love their life in this world will lose it. Those who care nothing for their life in this world will keep it for eternity. Anyone who wants to serve me must follow me, because my servants must be where I am, and the Father will honor anyone who serves me. Now my soul is in trouble. Should I pray, Father, save me from this hour? But this is the very reason I came. Father, bring glory to your name. Then a voice spoke from heaven, saying, I have already brought glory to my name, and I will do it again. When the crowd heard the voice, some thought it was thunder, while others declared an angel had spoken to him. Then Jesus told them, the voice was for your benefit, not mine. The time for judging this world has come, when Satan, the ruler of this world, will be cast out. And when I am lifted up from the earth, I will draw everyone to myself. He said this to indicate how he was going to die. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus, because he first loved me.
Thank you, baby. So we're looking at John 12 today. And this is kind of a continuation of John 3, believe it or not. Because remember last week we talked about when the Senate was lifted up upon the pole, so the Son of Man when he is lifted up. And that is the exact same Greek word, it also means exalted, by the way, that he uses here at the end of our passage from John 12. He says, and when I am lifted up from the earth, just like when he was lifted up on the pole, it's the same as lifted up on the pole, when I am lifted up, I will draw everyone to myself. So there's the connection with that. Let's begin with prayer. Thank you, Lord, for this day and this time that we have together. We pray that you'd open our eyes that we might see, open our ears that we might hear, enlighten our minds that we might understand, and open our hearts that we might receive the word that you have for us this day. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Now, the setting for this passage is kind of interesting. First of all, it takes place in Bethany, as far as we can tell. And this is Jesus. This is just outside of Jerusalem. He's going to be there for the last week of his life. It was there that he raised Lazarus from the dead. In fact, he's staying at the home of Lazarus as chapter 12 opens 6 days before the Passover. And we find Mary and Martha, who are the sisters of Lazarus, there gathered. And then Mary anoints Jesus' feet with oil. And it's very, very dramatic. It's an extravagant act of love. It's reported actually in all the Gospels. And then there's some mumbling among the disciples, particularly Judas Iscariot, who says this money is being wasted. That's a year's wages. We could have done it for the poor. Of course, he wasn't really concerned about the poor. Typical human response, right? And then we have the triumphal entry to Jerusalem, which we are going to talk about, of course, next week, because it's Palm Sunday. And then we have this interesting thing where these Greeks come to Philip, who's from Bethsaida in Galilee. That is actually more interesting than you think. Philip is a Greek name, means horse lover. And he, I don't think there's any significance to that, but maybe these Greeks were more easily identifying with Philip. He's also from Bethsaida, which is kind of a mixed community of Jews and Gentiles, Jews and Greeks. Now, Greeks is a synonymous term for Gentiles, by the way, because if you weren't a Jew in the ancient world, especially in the region they are, and you were a Greek, that was your Greek speaking. So you might be Assyrian, but you're Greek-speaking. You might be some other ethnicity. So it's not just Greeks, like they come from Greece, but they have this Greek influence. And there's at least some interest in Judaism because they're there for the Passover. Now, you're not going to Jerusalem to be at Passover time just to see the sights. You're going there because you have some interest. And so probably were. And there was this policy that you could go into the temple, but you could only stay in the court of the Gentiles, kind of outside the main thing. And in fact, it was really quite serious. The big sign said, no Gentiles allowed here, or no uncircumcised. And that's a really big deal. Paul got in trouble because they accused him of bringing an uncircumcised fellow, Timothy actually, with him into the temple. And it was wrong. You can't do that. But it wasn't true, but nevertheless, that was a charge against him. Well, anyway, so they're outside the Gentiles. So they come to Philip and they say, sir, we would see Jesus. Sir, we want to meet Jesus. Sir, we want to have an audience with Jesus. Sir, we want to have a discussion, an investigation with Jesus. We want to find out about this guy. Now, it kind of makes sense, right? He's causing a stir there in Jerusalem. He's making his mark. Things are going on. And so they heard about this rabbi. Why would a rabbi mean high exalted one? And the reason they're a teacher is because they're high exalted ones. They're ones that are, you know, have honor. They've been given a prestige, and so now they can teach, and you can listen to them, and you gather disciples around you. And those disciples are being trained as they listen to the rabbi. But Jesus is thoroughly good Jewish in that way. He's going right along. And so now these Greeks hear about this Jesus who was this rabbi, and we want to talk to him. We want to find out about him. We want to investigate. We want to have an audience with him. We want to discuss things with him. And so then Philip says, okay, well, I'll go talk to Andrew, and him go to Jesus. And Jesus launches into this thing that he says, now the time has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. It's interesting. Then he talks about seed going into the ground, and it's only when the seed goes into the ground and dies, it says dies. And of course, we know it doesn't die, but it reproduces and changes, and it becomes many things. So you take a seed, and then you get a tree or a bush or a plant of some kind, and then you got a lot of seeds. It's the way it reproduces many, many more than just the one. But if it doesn't, we just have the seed all of its own. That's kind of the point of the parable. And then he goes on to say, talk about, well, should I pray for God to take away or save me from this hour? No, I can't pray that. I have to pray now, Lord, essentially help me through this hour and glorify your name through me, through my actions. For this is the reason that you sent me. And the voice from heaven, they hear it, the thunder, they thought it was, some thought it was thunder, others thought it was an angel. I will glorify you, and I will glorify you again. And then Jesus says, and this is the verse that kind of ties it all together, and when I am lifted up, I will draw all people to myself. When I am lifted up. So we have this term, lifted up and exalted, and glorified. That's a head scratcher. Because what he's talking about in the Gospel of John is the cross. How is Jesus glorified? On the cross. Now, I have to tell you, if I was writing, I wouldn't say glorified. You could say, well, he did a really noble thing, he did a great thing, but glory is not the one word I would describe for an ignominious death on the cross. That was a death for, it's a horrible death. It's desecrating, it's humiliating, it has at its very core a mocking sense which says, you think you're somebody special, this is how you end up. It's public scorn, glory, exaltation. It doesn't make any sense in the face. But you know, there's a lot of things that are in Jesus' ministry that you kind of look at and you go, it doesn't make sense. Now, one of the things that happens is we get used to it. Okay? And we have to kind of disabuse ourselves of our knowledge. We know these stories, and they just become part of the fabric of faith. And they don't have the power they would if we lived in that context and heard it for the first time. Because we know the story. That crosses a little bit that way. We know the story. We know Sunday's coming. Okay, so he's crucified, but he's been raised from the dead. So we think about Jesus and his ministry. One of my favorite passages in the whole thing, one of the scenarios that I like the best, is when Jesus welcomes the little children, right? He says, he comes and he's got these children that are coming and pestering him. That's why the disciples understand it. Of course, because children don't matter. I have to tell you, we no longer feel that way. And so we don't think of it that way. I had a friend of mine who was a colleague of mine, 20 years older than me, said when he first started, when he grew up, it was an adult world, and all adults were mad, right? And the kids were kind of, seeing but not heard, that kind of thing. And then suddenly it translated into a kid's world. He goes, I missed out. I should have been at some point, in the important life. But we definitely live in a kid's world, right? In many ways. Well, that's not the way the ancient world was. The ancient world where kids are miniature adults just waiting to become productive. And the earlier you can get them productive, the better you are. Now think about that in the agrarian system. I used to tell the kids in class about that. Child labor laws, for example, don't apply it to the farm. You can have them out there slopping the pigs, milking the cows, doing all that kind of stuff. And you can always find these kids that were driving a truck or whatever way before they could get their license because they were on the farm and there's nobody to do it right. But this is the way it works. You just participate. You're in there. You're doing chores. As a demographic fact, I don't know. But when you go from rural to urban, number of children decreases. So on a farm, children are unpaid assets. In a city environment, they're liabilities. Man, are they liabilities. You know what? I just listened to my daughter last night. They're still liabilities, right? But that's just the way it works, right? And so now we see Jesus coming, the little children there, and from the disciples' perspective, they go, well, we can't get these children away from the rabbi because he's going to tell us something really important. He's got to think about profound things. He's got to do God's work. Explicating Torah. And then Jesus says, do not anger them. Let the little come to me, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. He calls out a little child and he blesses it. Another place he says, you got to become like a little child if you want to be a part of the kingdom. Who says that in that world? Then there's the issue of women. Women don't matter. Of course, I say that from a first century perspective. Thank God that I'm not a dog, a Gentile, or a woman. That was the prayer. Do women have a place in the kingdom? Do they even have a soul? That was a discussion in the first century. And so what did Jesus do? He's visiting the home of Lazarus, Mary, and Martha. And Mary is sitting there enwrapped in what Jesus is saying. She's sitting on the floor like a disciple. Like a disciple sitting on the floor. And Martha's tending to what she should be doing. She's in the kitchen. She's working. And she says, Mary, what's going on here? And Jesus says, Martha, Martha, you should have been concerned about what really matters. To be with Messiah. To be at his feet. Who needs food? Guess who the first witnesses to the resurrection are? Women. Guess whose testimony doesn't count in the ancient world? Women's. But they were the first witnesses to the resurrection. You see, something's going on here. This is not like you expect it to be. That's what C.S. Lewis said. What's so great about the gospel is that it's not what we expect it to be. It can't be made up, right? It's not somebody's invention, because they wouldn't have invented this. And the idea that you would take that the one you call king, Lord, is on a cross. What are you smoking? That's what we would say, right? That's crazy talk. On a cross, suffering and dying like a nothing, like a schmuck, nothing. How can that be? And yet it's in terms like this, is that it's glorified, it's exalted. Well, I think what's going on here is, so these guys want to see Jesus, and I think in this kind of roundabout way, he's saying, if you want to see Jesus, where do you got to go? You got to go to the cross. There you'll find what what Jesus is about. There you'll find what God is up to in the world. There you will find God himself. One of my favorite hymns. And can it be that I should gain an interest in the Savior's blood? Died he for me who caused his pain. For me, to him, a death pursued. But this is, of course, amazing love. How can it be that thou, my God, shouldst die for me? Where some people get their apples up a little bit. My God should die for me. How can God die? Here in the moment, has a great book. It's called The Crucified God. That's right. We're talking about crucifixion as this place where God comes to us most profoundly and most powerfully. Who could have thought that? But that's the amazing love of God. And we see that in John 3, right? How much does God love? For God so loved the world that he gave his one only son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. For God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world, but that through him the world might be saved. How do we know it? The cross. Go to the cross and you'll see how much God loves us. Go to the cross and you'll see the heart of God for the world. Go to the cross and you'll find what God is up to in his mission and ministry, reaching out, caring for the lost. It reminds me of the time that Jesus had dinner with some people that he shouldn't have had dinner with. Well, they were right sinners. And so some of the religious leaders hanging around there looked and said, if he really knew what was up, he would know that these people are sinners, and you don't have dinner with sinners. That almost rhymes with dinner with sinners. Right? Of course not. And guess what? They were sinners. They were. They didn't follow all Torah. They didn't do all the right things. They weren't clean. And Jesus says, but don't you understand? You don't send a doctor to the healthy, but to the sick. For the Son of Man came to seek and save that which was lost. In other words, I'm here for that. That's why I came. Not to condemn the world, but that through me the world would be saved. And how do you know that? You go to the cross. And you see just the extent to which God will go to make that happen. Remember he said, like a snake upon a pole, when the Son of Man is lifted up, those who believe in however, Paul says, while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. And the image you might really want to understand is that a hand risked it up in defiance. It says, God, I don't need you. I don't like you. I don't want to follow you. I don't want to be with you. I don't have anything to do with you. I'm going to go it on my own. God, I don't need you. And while our hands are lifted up in this defiance, Christ dies for us. When you go to the cross and you get that realization, understand that your rebellion, your sin, is nailed to the cross, and there is forgiveness and mercy and life, your change. Now, we read in Jeremiah 31 today, and he talks about this wonderful passage called the New Covenant, right? And the New Testament is New Covenant. That's what Testament means, covenant. So we have a New Covenant, we have an Old Covenant. And Jeremiah deals with all this. That's what it says. The day is coming, says Yahweh, when I will make a new covenant with my people, the people of Israel and Judah. This covenant will not be like the one I made with their ancestors when I took them by the hand and brought them out of the land of Egypt. They broke that covenant. Big shock. Though I love them as a husband loves his wife, says the Lord. No, I'm going to make a new covenant. I'll make with the people of Israel after those days. I will put my instructions deep within them. I love that they give instructions. I love it. I love it. I love it. You know, it doesn't mean law. You say, I have law in your heart. I always hate law because of what we associate with it. Could be different, but we have this idea of law. Thou shalt not, thou shalt. These are the instructions, God's way, God's will. You can put it in their heart. I will be their God, and they will be my people, and they will not need to teach their neighbors, nor will they need to teach their relatives, saying, you should know the Lord. For everyone from the least to the greatest will know. true. Oh, if that was just happened, if that was reality. Guess what? What do we say? In Jesus, the reality is there. We have a new covenant. And though we broke many other covenants, this new covenant in which God places his instructions in our hearts. He will be our God, we will be his people. How do we find that? We go to the cross. And there we'll see it at work in action. Everyone. And when I am lifted up, I will draw all people to myself. Now, I'll show you how this works. I want you to think about Paul. Saul of Tarsus. He was raised a Jew of Jews. He says that himself, a Pharisee of Pharisees from the tribe of Benjamin. He had great zeal for the traditions of his father, his elders. He followed the law punctiliously. He did everything you're supposed to do. He was advancing in Judaism far beyond those of his own age. That's his words. And it's being descriptive. It's not boasting. Later on, he's going to talk about, no, that is nothing. It's rubbish. It's on the dung heap compared with knowing Christ. But then he says something that I want you to think about. He says, for in Christ there is neither male nor female. Would he think that as a pious Jew? No chance. No chance. There is neither Jew nor Gentile. Would he think that in his training? From the instruction that he was given, no chance. Can't happen. There's a big distinction between Jews and Gentiles. Why? Because the Jews observe Torah. They follow God's instructions. They're God's special people. What are you talking about? Look at how awful the Gentiles are. They're rank sinners. They're polluted. They're idolaters. They do all kinds of terrible things. Paul mentions that in Romans 1. Then he mentions Romans 2. Guess what? You do too. You do the same thing. You Jews have got the law. So, he says there's neither Jew nor Gentile. What's he talking about? And then he says there's neither slave nor free. Oh, come on. Now you're going too far. Of course we know that slaves deserve to be there because they're inferior. If they weren't inferior, if they follow the phrasing, then they wouldn't be slaves. Of course now we know that there's other factors, right? That's the way they fly. And so now he says that all are one in Jesus Christ. If you've been baptized in Christ, you're one in Christ. And doesn't matter, male or female, slave or free, Jew nor Gentile. Where did they get that? Where did that come from? Honestly, it comes from God. But more specifically, it comes from the cross. It comes from the one who's on the cross, and it says that it is for the world he dies. He doesn't die for the Jews, he dies for the world. And if Christ died for the world, then anybody that I look at, anybody I stare at, I'm looking at someone for whom Christ died. Now, suddenly, I got to change my attitude. Even though I feel superior, I know I'm not. Because we all stand in the same need. We're all rank sinners. We stand in need of the mercy and grace of God. Now, it is true that we have faltered on occasion, right? You look at the history of the church, you see that happening. But sometimes it's better to look at how it really has worked. No other religion in the history of the world, listen to me carefully, no other religion in the history of the world has been more inclusive, more international, reaching out to more people than is the Christian faith. There's not even a close second. Now, there's a lot of numbers. Look at the Muslim. It goes across the Arab world and across that, and it's basically ethnic. Christianity, I love it. The only place you can really see this is when they have a conclave of bishops in the Vatican. And then you look and you see all the different faces, right, from the church around the world. Now, we could do Protestants, we do that, but unfortunately, we don't ever have a gathering like that. And you go, it's everywhere. The Bible's been translated into more languages than any other book in human history. Someone has said, we're just really at the verge now of having translated in every single language in the world. And some of those are real minor languages. I mean, really hard to, few people speak it. Where does that come from? It's the cross. You go to the cross and you say, these are people for whom Christ died. We better tell them. We better let them know that God loves them so much that he dies for them. And that changes our view. It gives us an understanding of who God is and what God is. We find God's heart in the cross. And that's why we can say that Friday is good. That's why we can raise, lift high the cross and proclaim why the love of Christ proclaimed. So we have to constantly focus on the cross. It's easy to get callous to it and just, man, that's the way it is. But it's only that we truly understand it. It's only as we truly journey to the cross again, 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 that we're going to meet Jesus. That we're going to understand Jesus. That we're going to have an audience with Jesus. Now later on we'll talk about why the cross is the most effective, and that's where the resurrection comes in. But that's 2 weeks. First, we have to go to the cross. And that's where we discover God in the flesh. That's right. Thank you, Lord, for saving our souls. Thank you, Lord, for making us whole. Thank you, Lord, for giving to us your great salvation so rich and free. We know that that salvation is purchased. That redemption was won by the one who suffered and died. Because of that, we now see his glory and exaltation. Because when he is lifted up, he draws all persons to himself. May your name be ever praised, O great and glorious God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us continue with the recitation of the Nicene Creed. Let us confess the faith in one holy, Catholic, that is universal, and the Apostolic Church. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten from the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten and not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things are made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, and the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge the baptism, the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead, and the life of the world to come. Amen. Thank you, Mr. Seder. Are there any prayer requests that need to be made? Any prayer requests? Yes, sir.
Prayers for Uncle Charles. He's got some health issues at this time.
Charles. Okay. Pray for Charles. Yes,
for the new pacemaker. I'm having it installed on Wednesday.
Okay. Pray for Shirley. I'm getting a new pacemaker. Yes.
Mm-hmm. Prayer of thanks. Get rid of this horse collar tomorrow.
Praise the Lord. Anybody else? Continue prayers for Carolyn, Amy's daughter, who her baby has a growth on the heart and is definitely there. And the question is how serious? So that's going to be an ongoing process. She's going to meet with a cardiac pediatrician sometime soon. They've got a bunch of appointments lined up, so they're going to first monitor it. At this point, everything looks good. So the baby's growing, kicking, doing what it's supposed to do. So out of the ashes, up from the dust, we bring our prayers to God, saying, in your steadfast love, O Lord, God of all mercy, we pray for the church. Teach us to treasure your word, the grace of the faithfulness of your people, so that we all may know that you are our God, and in your steadfast love, O Lord. God of all mercy, we pray for the world. Drive out false leaders and wicked rulers. Draw all people to your way of truth and life, bringing justice and peace to everyone. In your steadfast love, O Lord. O God of all mercy, we pray for this community and the communities in which we live. Hasten the coming of that great day when all people, from the greatest to the least, when all the promise of your holy realm, in your steadfast love, O Lord.
Have mercy on us.
God of all mercy, we pray for our loved ones. Hear the prayers and tears of all who suffer. By the saving power of Christ Jesus, deliver them from sickness, sin, and death. In your steadfast love, O Lord.
Have mercy on us.
And O Lord, we lift up the concerns we have just raised. We pray for Charles. We pray for Shirley and the procedure she's going to have. We're thankful for Bob's recovery. We pray that it'll continue to go well. We pray for Rhonda as she deals with her situation. To all of them, give your grace, your mercy, and your love. We pray for Carolyn and the baby. We pray that you would watch over and bless her. We pray for those who are on our prayer list, those with chronic situations and difficulties. We pray that your healing love would surround them, and your blessing would be upon them. Bless all of our families, our loved ones. Bless our homes. We're thankful for this place, for what it means to us, for the blessing that resides here. For those who have gone before us, we give thanks. We pray that we be faithful now and be a blessing to those who come after us. Lord, in all that we do, to glorify your holy name. And now we conclude. Restore in us, O God, the joy of your salvation. Renew and sustain our spirits so that we may live according to your will. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, and strength, our hope and strength. Amen. Let's join together in a great thanksgiving. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks for your grace.
Blessed are you, O Lord our God. You have made a new covenant with your people, remembering our sin no more, and writing your law within our hearts, so that we might all know you from the greatest to the least. Therefore we praise you, joining the song of the universal church, and the heavenly choir. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is Jesus Christ, our Savior. When the hour came for Christ to be glorified, and you lifted him up upon a cross, so that all the earth might see and believe in him. We give you thanks that the Lord Jesus, in the night before he died, took bread. And after giving thanks to you, he broke it, gave it to his disciples, and said, take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. The same way, after supper, he took the cup. Again, he gave thanks. Gave it to his disciples and said, this cup is a new covenant, sealed in my blood, shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Drink it as often as you shall drink it in remembrance of me. Therefore, let us proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Remembering your goodness and grace, we offer ourselves to you with gratitude as we share this joyful feast. Pour out your Holy Spirit upon us, and upon this your bread and cup. Make us one in body, in the body and blood of Jesus Christ our Lord. Through your Spirit, we are fed with spiritual food, a mystery we proclaim with our lives. This bread is Christ's body for us, and we are the body of Christ. Through the Lord Jesus Christ, in the unity of the Spirit, we bless you, God our Father, now and forever. And as our Savior Christ has taught us to pray, so we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Christ, our Passover has been sacrificed for us, therefore let us keep the feast. The body of Christ, broken for you, take and eat, and remember that Christ died for you. The blood of Christ, the cup of salvation, take and drink in remembrance that Christ died for you. And amen. Let's pray. Eternal God, our Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. And you have fed us with the spiritual food and the sacrament of his body. Send us now into the world in peace and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let's continue by singing Beneath the Cross. Amen.